Alright, hello and welcome to the Slingshot channel. Today I have a guest. Let me introduce Dr. John Reid to you, who I understand is the chairman of the Trimontium Fund, right?
Yes, we are. We're a small organisation that explore Roman sites in the south of Scotland, particularly the one at Trimontium, but we are very interested in the battle that potentially took place at Burnswark Hill. And York has agreed to help us with some experimentation to look at what might have happened.
You know, these experts coming to me to research a battle. I mean, come on, how cool is that? Tell me about that battle. You know, when did it take place?
We think it took place in the 2nd century AD.
So 1800 years ago.
1800 years ago, between the Romans and the native Scots, the Caledonians.
And the Romans have been the aggressors, I understand.
Yes, the Romans were invading Scotland.
Flat out. That's what they wanted.
Full on.
Kill everyone, you know, take over the country.
Yep. Take whatever there was and then call it part of Rome.
Okay, all right. And that battle took place about how far from the Hadrian's Wall?
It's probably about 20 miles, you know, 20, 25 kilometers north of Hadrian's Wall.
So pretty much the first thing they stepped into when they left their secluded territory.
Across the wall, straight into this site.
Okay. Then explain that site to me, will you? We're going to use my gravel heap to explain an 1800 years old site. Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, so we've got a native hill fort here on the summit of the hill.
That's where the Caledonians built their fortifications.
Yep. Their round houses, their huts are on the summit of this.
And a wooden fence wall, whatever.
Possibly a wooden fence, possibly no fence at all. May have been an open settlement at the time.
Okay.
But the Romans wanted rid of these guys, so they built two camps. One on the...
Oh. Oops. Sorry for that.
Okay. One on the south side.
Okay.
Here.
And that was a typical fortification like you know from Asterix, you know.
Exactly.
Typical the Roman fashion.
Roman fashion, dug a ditch, built the wall, and then in front of it they placed three platforms for ballistas for these catapults, big catapults, to allow them to cast missiles up the hill.
And it probably only took them a couple of days to erect all
very,
this.
Very, very rapid.
Because they were very efficient.
Yeah, 24, 48 hours to dig the ditch and create the mounds.
Wow. And how many Romans in that fort?
3,000 to 4,000.
3,000 to 4,000.
Yeah. And then another one on the north side to prevent escape.
So they had another one here, right?
So just there. Yeah.
And that was just to block them from any kind of supply route.
Yeah. That was to keep them on the summit.
Okay. And then the thing is that before they stormed this, they bombarded it.
Yeah.
Right? So with all kinds of missiles, with the ballistas that they had, with bows and arrows, and they also used slings.
Slings. Right? So lead slingshot, iron arrowheads, and stone ballista balls.
And you found hundreds of those,
hundreds,
right?
Nearly 700 lead sling bullets.
And those are only from the small parts of the land that you excavated, right?
Yeah, these are the only from the parts that we can get access to, and there's probably many, many more.
And the ancient scripts say that there were thousands of bullets and it was a hailstorm.
Before any assault, they would literally storm the front rampart of the hill fort.
So they would really take a lot of bullets and just throw them at these guys on the hilltop, right?
Just shower the whole front.
And eventually they succeeded, right?
Yeah.
Well, killed everyone, wiped it out.
Would have been a wipeout.
Right. Okay. But there still is an unresolved mystery about this. And that's one of the reasons why you came, I understand.
Absolutely.
Let's get into detail.
Yeah.
Okay, so these are reproductions of the bullets that you found, right?
Yep.
And some of them, how nice, they even put my initials on it. Yes, I love that. I'm not going to shoot this one, though. But this is a typical lead projectile for a sling, I would say.
Yeah.
Very much. This is where you get most of the energy if you sling it with
it. It's a standard bullet that we find.
And that weighs about 60 grams?
60 grams,
And you found hundreds of those?
Yeah, literally.
Which means that there have been thousands in reality.
Yeah. We're only finding a small proportion of
And those are only the ones their kids back then didn't find.
So. Yeah, or anybody else.
Yeah, because that was valuable, I guess.
Yeah, metal, like that was valuable.
But that is not the only one you found. The ones that are so hard to understand are different. Let's go to those.
Yep.
Okay, the interesting part is that you also found hundreds of those.
Yeah.
Which are about 20% of the bullets that you found were like this.
Yeah.
So a lot smaller.
Mm-hmm.
And not as heavy, around 20 grams, you said?
20 grams, yeah.
And, you know, they all had a hole drilled into them.
Yeah.
About 4 millimeters in diameter and about 5 to 6 millimeters deep.
The hole's virtually almost the same size.
And you would wonder why someone in a world where there's no electric drill would take the time to do that, because it's probably complicated, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of manual
fiddly.
Work.
Very fiddly.
Right. It's so there must be a reason for that. They wouldn't have done it if it wouldn't be necessary.
It's not an accident.
And you have three theories how, you know, what is the purpose of this.
Yep. First theory was it was for poison. They put poison in the hole so that if it penetrated the flesh, it would subsequently poison the victim.
Mm-hmm.
The second theory was that it was for attaching to some device that would perhaps fired 3 or 4 of them at a time in a cluster.
Mm-hmm.
And the third theory was that they made a sound. They whistled.
They whistled.
They made a sound that the enemy could hear coming towards them, because the bullets were invisible in flight. So how do you terrify people? You give them shock tactics, but you also give them psychological tactics with sound.
So a little bit like in World War I when the grenades came whistling in. And
the Stuka in World War II.
The Stukas, yeah.
So that's, you know, that's...
And you tested this a little bit and you found that they do whistle, right?
They do whistle. They make a buzzing sound, but we didn't get the velocities that we think you can produce. So very keen to come to the expert in ballistics and let us know whether one of these theories has more power than the other.
So we will put every one of these theories to a test today. That's going to be exciting. All right, we have heated up the lead. Now we take a little piece of wood to clean off the dirt. Bye-bye dirt. Now we are using this beautiful cast to make 14 millimeter projectiles. And we'll drill the holes in later. All right, as you see, 10 perfect balls. Now some of the 16. Let's have a look. Looks like a perfect batch. Of course, you must get rid of the stem. That's it. And it goes back into the melting pot. Okay, now we cast our bullets. We have the 14 millimeter and the 60 millimeter. And they should weigh about as much as the ones that you found, right?
Yeah, 20, 25 grams, round about that.
Okay, well, we won't be able to use any in oval shape, but my brother, who is a physicist, said that it doesn't matter. It could be round. The hole is the important part. So let's drill a hole in here and see if they chatter. All right, 4 millimeter drill. Just put it in. And then... So we now have a lot of bullets with a 4 millimeter hole that is about 5 to 6 millimeters deep, like the originals. But there's one thing I want to test. I want to use other sizes to see if they create a different sound. Now, why do I want to do that? Well, there must have been a reason why they used 4 millimeter and drilled it that deep, and not 6 millimeter and not 2 millimeters. And if it's really true that they did this because of the chirping, of the whistling effect, then a 6 millimeter and a 2 millimeter must be less efficient in creating that noise. Therefore, that's what I'm going to test. since I am very bad with the sling, I hit all over the place, but not in the direction I want to aim at. I've built something that simulates a perfect slinger. This is actually a combination of a slingshot, a sling, and a trebuchet. I christened it the rabouchet. Let me show you its features. So as you see, it has this long swing arm and an axis. And of course, it is powered by lots of rubber instead of weight. So this is working with rubber force and not with gravity like an original trebuchet would be. After all, this is the slingshot channel. And attached to the pole is a classic sling or David sling. It really is the same. As you see, it's fixed mounted on one side, on here. And we have a pouch. And on the other end, we have this little loop that on a normal David sling, you would put this over your index finger or so. In this case, we're putting it on this nail up here, like this. Now, the angle of that nail is very important because it means that it gives you the shooting angle. The more it is tilted forward, so it's rotated around this axis here, then the lower it will shoot, and the more it is tilted backward, the higher it will shoot. Down here we have the release. So this is a foot pedal release. You hit the foot pedal and the whole thing launches.
Ready for the shot. And wow! And fire! Wow! Fire! I did hear it whistling. I did hear it.
All right, John. So I did hear it whistling.
Yeah, it did definitely whistle that day.
And it was really fast. I would probably think this is faster than you can do it with a handheld sling,
yeah.
Right?
One of the things is we're hearing the trebuchet as well, so we're not actually getting the full sound. So I wonder if a handheld sling might give you the quietness that you need to hear the bullet in action.
Yeah, it might. Actually, that's not a problem. We have enough slingshots here for sure. We are using a Rambone with a double layer Theravent gold bend set and a 16 millimeter lead ball with a 4 millimeter hole. Wow, it's chattering away like a bird, only more deadly.
Perfect.
Now we're testing the 14 millimeter, but with a 4 millimeter hole, so same hole size. Let's see if there is a different sound. I think it's probably a little more high pitched. Don't you think? It was probably faster. Maybe faster. That is the reason why it was twittering away at a higher at a higher pitch.
Yep.
Now for comparison, we are now shooting a 16 millimeter ball bearing made from steel. This is perfectly round, and this is not supposed to cause any kind of noise in flight. I don't know why, but steel balls always feel great in the pouch. No, silent. So the fact that we are hearing this now from here where we're standing, you can hear that it's of course fading away. But on the other side, on the receiving end, it would get louder and louder, right? Yeah. And before it hits you.
Yeah, absolutely. You're going to get a Doppler effect as well as it goes past your head.
Oh, that was a good one. Yeah. Now imagine hundreds of people doing this at the same time.
Yeah.
And you're in the middle, protected by virtually nothing, right?
Nothing.
Yeah, that is scary.
Yep.
Now we want to research a little bit on the hole diameter. 3 millimeter hole, 16 millimeter lead ball. I was about the same, I would say. It didn't really differ all that much. Yeah. All right, now we have the big hole, 6 millimeter hole into the 60 millimeter lead ball. I think that was different. Yeah. It was a different sound.
Yeah.
But not that much different. I think we can say that the size of the hole does not matter very much. The sound is almost as loud, and I think also the pitch is about the same.
Yeah.
So this means that there's probably another reason why they use the 4mm hole. Our facts, they do whistle.
Yeah.
And they do that loud enough for everyone to hear.
Yeah.
Even in a battle, I think.
Yeah.
So that's clear. But we also know that the hole size doesn't really matter much.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. So there must be a reason why they took thousands of lead bullets and drilled the exact same hole into each one.
And the holes were all exactly the same diameter.
So my personal theory, and that is one of your theories as well, is that it was used to stick them onto something.
Yeah.
And I believe it could have been a launching stick. I believe that probably this is so much easier to launch them on the top of a stick
mm-hmm.
with a tip that matches the diameter of the hole, and that mm-hmm. could be a metal tip or just carved out of the same wood, and then launch it. So I'd like to test if it's possible to use a branch or a stick
mm-hmm.
and throw them with more force than you can muster by just hand,
mm-hmm.
which isn't very much.
So it's almost like a staff sling, where you have a stick to extend the length of your arm, but you're fixing the bullet onto the end of that to stabilize it before you fire it.
Yes, because I believe that it's quicker to reload. But let's test this, because I've never done it,
mm-hmm.
and it's just right now it's just a theory, and we have to test it.
Well, it sounds like a good theory. Let's
okay,
go.
Let's go ahead. I've made a launching stick from a wooden dowel and tipped with a nail that mm-hmm. has a 4mm diameter. And it is very easy to just put the lead ball on it, like this.
Easy.
Now let's test if we can launch it.
I feel a little bit like Gandalf. Let's see if I can cast a lead ball against this door. I sure can, wow.
Wow.
That was mighty force. That's definitely a lot harder than I could throw it by hand.
Well, that's impressive.
And I could not do the same with a sling. I would have to practice this for years before I'm that efficient. Let's test how fast you can fire with this. All right, put it in, throw it. That is scary powerful. Next one. Next one. Okay. Next one. My poor barn, it's taking a beating. Okay, there it is. That's it, 5 shots.
And I think I could probably get more efficient with this if I would practice a little bit, just like an afternoon or so. But this firing rate, I think, is higher than any other weapon that they had at that time for an unpracticed man. Only probably a practiced archer could probably go better than this, or maybe mm-hmm. even.
Yeah.
But with simple projectiles and a weapon that you can make it within 2 minutes. It twittered. I heard it. So, John, what do you think about my little throwing stick?
Well, I think it's very impressive, Jörg. The distance that you're projecting these is at least the distance from the front rampart of the Roman camp to the front rampart of the native hill fort. So this thing is allowing a man to hand throw a bullet straight into the enemy camp. I'm impressed.
Of course, it doesn't mean that they used it, but they could have.
They could have used it.
They could have. We just proved that it is possible.
Yeah.
And actually, it is really easy to do.
Yeah.
Now, of course, this is the Slingshot channel. So When we find that something works, we have to maximize out so that it's ridiculous. So can we make a magnum version of this?
Okay.
I think we can.
Listen.
Let me show you what I came up with. Meet the Roman Leadcaster 2000. Let's test it out. Yeah, it twittered. All right, so the next thing that we want to find out is penetration power of the projectiles.
Yep.
And now you're not so much interested in the small pellets anymore.
No.
You want to know the 40 and 60 gram caliber sizes, right?
Yeah.
If they could really penetrate a human body.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a big debate about how penetrative they were. Was it a concussive blow that they gave? Did it break bones? Did it shatter skulls? Or did it actually penetrate the body?
So what I have made to put this to a test, I used this old slingshot rifle of mine, and I banded it up with a band set that I think is about as powerful as an average slinger could cast a ball. This means that the 60 gram would fly at around 35 meters per second, and the lighter, the 30 gram type, would fly at about 45 meters per second.
Perfect.
Of course, there are slingers that could fire harder. And also, I think I can do it also harder with a normal slingshot. But not everyone is a superstar. Yeah. And they wouldn't build this weapon just for the few elite throwers. It has to have enough power for the average man. Therefore, I think this is the right force. Let's test it against this naked block of gelatin and see if it has any penetration chance.
Perfect.
Let's see if we can hit it. Wow!
Whoa.
Is that enough penetration for you? As you see, it travels through the whole block, and I can actually see it. It is... That's clearly a fatal wound.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And this possibly is what would have happened to a naked Caledonian. What about a Caledonian wearing clothes?
And well, but anyway, I think Caledonians fought naked. That's what they say, right? Just clad in their tattoos.
Yeah, just tattoos.
But I think under that bombardment, they would have given that up rather quickly and covered themselves with every little bit that they had. But let's test what happens when we put clothing in front of it and then see how much penetration we then get. All right, this is this is from an old towel, I think, or from an old bathrobe, because I would think that they used rather sturdy but coarse textiles, fabrics, right?
Yep.
So this could be perfect.
And fire.
Whoop, almost hit me. So John, you saw that the result of the test was entirely different. Actually, there was no permanent penetration, but you also saw that there was a tremendous shock, right?
Yeah.
And I guess, as a doctor, you can say that this wouldn't have ended well for the guy, right?
No, anything that would shift the gelatin that far, if it hit you in the chest, would have pushed your breastbone back, could even have stopped your heart.
And I also think that you can see that it did do a little bit of penetration probably through the fabric.
Yeah.
This means we also look at a bleeding wound.
Yeah.
Probably not a huge amount of blood.
Yeah, it would have contusion, it would have pushed the bone, if it had hit bone, it would have pushed bone back. Yeah.
Okay. But that again, that is my point. It is the blunt force that does the damage.
Yeah.
And we now know what would happen if we would hit the center of mass in the body. But let's think about what would happen if you get a headshot from one of these.
Oh.
And for testing headshots, there's nothing better than coconuts.
Okay,
so that is a coconut, and it is very hard to crack it.
Yeah.
So, of course, that's not a human skull analog.
No.
But I think if the shot can crack the coconut, it would be lethal for a human if you hit the human above the upper lip, I think.
Yeah. And the ancient authors describe frequently headshots from slinging, and the slingers were taught to go for the head.
And fire! Whoa!
Whoa!
Whoa! Okay, now that's what I call a fatal blow, right?
Yeah, definitely. It penetrated the skull. The bullet's still inside the cavity. It's a total wipeout.
And the contents are gone. I mean, all the juice.
Yeah, it's gone.
That would not look pretty
if
it hits a body or a head.
And you pointed out that this is a medium strength power.
Average.
Catapult. So
not the superstars.
Yeah.
Superstars will probably have shot it right through.
Right through. Yeah. So it's a contest that's over, really.
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
So no wonder that they eventually won.
Yeah.
They threw enough bullets up there until, of course, there was probably only a few men left standing.
Yeah.
And then they just went in and...
Yeah. Well, it shows you the power of ancient firepower. I mean, it's incredible.
Right. Okay. All right, so we have established that the big bullets could not penetrate through someone with clothes on.
Yeah, you've shown that conclusively, yep.
Of course, you know, the big bullets didn't have any holes in them in the first place, but the small ones had. So it is possible that, you know, your theory is true, that it was used to transfer poison into the body.
Mm-hmm.
But that would mean that it would be able to penetrate through clothes.
Yeah.
Since in the skull you don't need any poison in a headshot and you're dead.
It's dead.
So it must be a body shot, and this means that to transfer poison you must break skin and actually embed this thing into it. So let's test with the slingshot if we can penetrate through the fabric into the gelatin.
Yeah.
Because if we can't do it, then the poison theory is garbage.
Dead.
Right.
Dead. Great.
So that is a surprise.
That's
I did not
expect
that. That's
a big surprise.
It went through the fabric and it tore a hole through it.
Yeah.
Here it is.
Yeah. Shocker.
It went through the entire ballistic gelatin, even though it had to penetrate through the fabric first.
Yeah.
So maybe that poison theory has something to it.
Yeah.
But you know what? Maybe it's all three things combined.
Yeah. Could be. Could be. It's the ultimate weapon.
So even if you put it on a stick, why not putting a little poison in it?
Yeah. And it whistles.
And it whistles. And you could throw it on a stick.
That is absolutely unbelievable.
So, conclusion. What have we established?
Okay. Well, the things we set out to look at, did they whistle?
Sure.
Definitely
whistled. Loud enough, and it actually they whistled every time, right?
Yeah.
No matter where we shot them from, it's a reliable whistle, and it's definitely loud.
Okay. Did the hole have another function other than whistle?
Maybe. We don't know that. But the size of the hole doesn't really matter. We showed that even a bigger or a smaller hole would sound pretty much the same.
Yep.
So the other function must have something to do with the same size.
Yeah. And they were all the same size. So the stick theory looks like a viable theory. It can cast these bullets from a relatively inexpert slinger over the required distance to hit the hill for them.
I think we approved that they work in general.
Yeah.
Or would have worked, but we have no proof that it actually happened that way.
Yeah.
We don't know that. It's just an assumption, and it needs more proof.
Yeah.
So.
But it's a viable theory.
Now research has something to work, you know, so something to explore further on.
Yep.
And we also looked at the penetration power, and with the big sling balls, I think we established that those were definitely lethal.
Yeah.
A headshot would certainly kill you right away.
Outright. Yep.
Game over. And even a body hit would disable you from any further fighting.
A lot of momentum, a lot of energy.
Right. And then the surprising part was that I thought this poison idea was completely ridiculous. Let's be upfront with you. I thought that is nonsense. But actually, the small bullets have more penetration power through clothes.
Yeah.
So that is still a viable theory. Mm. But of course, just like our stick shot theory, there's no proof that it happened that way.
Yeah.
It's just an assumption.
Yeah.
Well, brilliant. I think we have done some valuable work today, right?
Serious archaeology.
Right. Okay, guys, that's it for today. I hope you liked it. Thanks and bye-bye.